With acoustic intensity, we cover the trifecta of acoustic sound measurements in the physical domain. The other two are sound pressure and sound power, which we've already covered before. So it shouldn't come as a surprise to you when I state that acoustic intensity can be expressed as some physical unit of measure and can also be expressed in decibels, similar to the others. To understand more though, let's look at the definition. It states that acoustic intensity or sound intensity is defined as the flow of sound energy per second carried by the sound waves per unit area in a direction perpendicular to that area. Alright, let's break it down though. So there's the flow of sound energy per second, which is actually just sound power, which immediately confirms that intensity is a power quantity and not a field quantity. That gives us a lot of intuition about what it could be. And the power carried by sound waves is per unit area. So intensity is power over area, or in derived units, that would be watt per meter squared. And finally, the direction of this sound wave is perpendicular to the area. So sound intensity is a directional quantity and represents the direction of propagation of the sound wave. This is a unique attribute that differentiates intensity from pressure and power. The other two are non-directional, and it doesn't give you any indication of where a particular source of sound is located. But in other aspects, sound intensity shares similar properties as power and pressure. Just like pressure, sound intensity changes based on the distance from the source. The further away you are from the source, the lesser the sound intensity at a cross-sectional area of space. And just like sound power, intensity is a calculated value. It needs a fairly controlled and complex setup to measure and calculate the values. So the real advantage of knowing sound intensity is the directionality aspect of it. We'll get to that later. Sound intensity is the power per unit area. Let's consider a source vibrating and resonating in a free field, meaning that there's no obstacles to the path of the sound waves in a three-dimensional space, and the energy of the sound waves are not absorbed into its surroundings. It's quite obvious to note that these sort of spaces are incredibly hard to emulate in the real world. But hypothetically, let's say that this exists. A sound wave emanating from this source always has a sphere of influence. The sound waves travel outwards in all directions, similar to how a ripple originates in still water when a pebble is thrown in. But just imagine that in three-dimensional space. So when you want to calculate the intensity of sound across a certain area of space, the area needs to be either a part of the surface area of this sphere, or it could be the surface area of the entire sphere. Calculating sound intensity across the entire sphere of influence is quite easy. We just need to know the sound power of the source and the distance you are from the source. The distance from the source will essentially become the radius of the sphere. And we can mathematically calculate the surface area of the sphere with the formula 4 pi r square. So you can also notice that intensity is inversely proportional to the square of the distance from the source. Intensity follows the inverse square law, where intensity decreases exponentially the further away you are from the source. Contrast that to sound pressure, the pressure drops linearly the further away you are from the source. We can visualize why intensity drops exponentially. Let's say we calculate the sound intensity at a meter away from the source, at a certain cross-sectional area of space. The sound intensity here represents the energy of the sound flowing through this patch. As the sound wave travels further, at 2 meters from the source, the sound energy that was once flowing through that patch is now flowing through a larger area of space. More precisely, 4 times larger than before. The energy is merely redistributed to a larger area of space. So the intensity drops by 4. Similarly, at 3 meters from the source, the intensity drops by 9. So you can see that the intensity is inversely proportional to the square of the distance. Let's talk a bit about the concept of directionality. From the formula for sound intensity that we saw, as being the power carried by sound waves over a unit area, this doesn't actually give us any notions of directionality. It's just a scalar quantity. There's another way of expressing sound intensity, and it's through this formula, where the sound intensity is the product of the pressure at a region and the velocity of the particles at that region. Don't worry about the units. The two expressions might look different on paper, but they boil down to the same derived units of watt per meter squared. Here, pressure is a scalar quantity, meaning that it just has some value associated with it. But velocity is a vector quantity. In mathematics and geometry, a vector is a quantity which has both magnitude and direction. Here, the velocity has some value which represents the speed of oscillations of the particles, and also a spatial direction which represents the tendency of oscillations in a particular direction. And intensity inherits this property of directionality. What does this mean in practice, though? If you were to look at pressure holistically, it gives you quite a good picture of where the pressure disturbances are. From this picture, you can see spots of red, which are regions of high pressure, and spots of yellow and green, which are regions of comparatively lower pressure. But it doesn't lend itself to give you any perception towards the direction of travel. Take the source away, and you lose context, and it sort of leaves you confused. Why is there a pressure disturbance there? And which direction is this localized fluctuation of pressure traveling in? These questions can't really be answered from a pressure map of a single snapshot in time. Instead, let's see how we can visualize intensity for the same scenario. Here, the sound intensity snapshot doesn't just represent the magnitude as a heat map from red to green. It also represents the direction of flow of sound energy at every point in space. This is valuable information if different sources of sound exist and you want to isolate a particular sound from an environment. Acoustic intensity is not of great interest to the auditory system in itself. Our ears don't perceive changes in velocity of particles. We only perceive changes in pressure. But intensity is vitally important for extracting meaning from sounds in an environment. I am no acoustic consultant, so I might not know the precise details, but here's the general way one would approach to measure and calculate the sound intensity at a distance in an environment. You take a matched pair of microphones and place them at a predetermined distance apart. The matched pair would have similar characteristics so that the sensitivity and frequency response of the two microphones are as close to each other as possible. By looking at the phase difference between the recordings of the two microphones, among other things, the direction of the sound can be determined. Lastly, to finish off this piece, let's talk briefly about sound intensity level. If you've seen the other videos, you might have noticed that sticking the term level at the end of the quantity usually means the representation of a quantity in the decibel scale. There's no difference here. The sound intensity level in decibels, or SIL, is just 10 times the log of the ratio of the intensity to our reference intensity. The reference here is the lowest intensity of sound a person with normal hearing can perceive at a frequency of 1000 Hz. And that's 10 to the power of minus 12 watt per meter square. Sound intensity for most sounds that we perceive on a day-to-day basis is quite small. But one of the most striking things about the reference intensity is how infinitesimally small this value is. How remarkable that our ears are able to perceive sounds this low. Even more impressive when you realize that the area of the eardrums is only about 1 centimeter squared. So in essence, the actual value of the sound energy that flows through our eardrums is 10 to the power of minus 16 watt at the threshold of hearing. Air molecules in a sound wave of this intensity vibrate over a distance of less than 1 molecular diameter. Ridiculous. Okay, so this is pretty much the last time we'll be talking about sound power or intensity. We may briefly touch upon sound pressure from time to time, but not much, I presume. These concepts are not really important for what we're going to talk about next. But I'll give you a small example of how decibel representations of these concepts can unify and simplify our measurements. Let's say that there's a source of sound producing a pressure difference of 1 millipascal at some distance from the source. And let's say that at the same distance, the calculated acoustic intensity is around 2.5 times 10 to the power of minus 9 watt per meter squared. Let's say you move the distance such that sound pressure is doubled. When you double sound pressure, the sound intensity is actually quadrupled because of its inverse square relationship with distance. Now, all you wanted to convey is that you double the pressure. Keeping track of all of these numbers and concepts is unnecessary and ugly. Let's bring decimals into the picture. Double the pressure, you get plus 6 dB of SPL. Quadruple the intensity, and you get plus 6 dB of SIL. So you don't really need to think about pressure or intensity when you're dealing with relative changes of values. Both the decibel value of pressure and intensity will beautifully just equate to the same thing, which is one of the nice quirks of the decibel unit. Awesome. So if you're still sticking around in the series, you're a legend. Coming up next is probably one of my favorite topics to talk about. We'll leave the physical domain and talk about sound signal measurements in the analog and digital domains.